Hello and welcome to Candela. In this anthropology lecture, let us discuss the formalist and substantivist debate in economic anthropology. Karl Polanyi, the great Australian historian, philosopher, economist, and a great anthropologist in the year 1944, he published the book The Great Transformation. In this book, he discussed about the decline of classical liberal thought and the decline of laissez-faire capitalism. In fact, he starts the book with the very first statement, the 19th century civilization has collapsed. By 19th century civilization, he referred to the then European civilization. He makes a note about the irreversible socio-economic changes which happens in the society because of the market economy. For example, the terms like poverty was not common prior to 17th century. The term unemployment was not common before Industrial Revolution. This particular book created a debate in the economic anthropology. It is so called the formalist and the substantivist debate. In fact, it's Karl Polanyi who coined the term substantivist and the formalist. Who are formalists? So according to Karl Polanyi, formalists derive their inspiration from neoclassical economics. According to them, whatever laws which we make in economics have universal applicability, be it law of demand, be it law of supply, be it law of diminishing marginal returns, be it law of diminishing marginal utility, whatever may be the laws, we can apply it to any society on the earth. Their basic assumption is actors choose among the alternatives to maximize their preference. Insufficiency, scarcity, and scarce or rational use of scarce means. Rational use of scarce means were the central theme of the formalist. But the substantivist, on the other hand, they are called as institutionalist. They focus much on the organizational differences found among different economies. And they do not believe that the universal applicability of economic laws. So they divide the economy into two types, market economy and the empirical economy. And the principles followed are the laws which were made for the market economy. We cannot apply the same laws in the primitive economy also, and the so-called empirical economy. So these two group of anthropologists, they debated on three important issues. The issues are, number one, the concept of insufficiency, scarcity, and choice. And number two, types of economy. And then the forms of trade, money, and market elements. Now let us discuss the first debate. The first debate, that is the concept of insufficiency, scarcity, and choice. For formalists, right, the scarcity postulate requires that there should be insufficiency of means. See, according to them, human needs are unlimited because we human beings are having unlimited desires. But the material means, right, it's not always sufficient to meet our needs. So there is always an insufficiency of means. This insufficiency of means is because of scarcity. And the scarcity postulates, as per the formalists, right, according to them, it says that choice will be induced because of this insufficiency. So it is the insufficiency and the scarcity which introduces choice in the system. And see, they also further say that in order that choice to be induced into that system, there should be more than one use for the means and more than one end ordered in a sequence of preference. It's slightly confusing, right? So in order that, see, as I told you, it is on the insufficiency of means and scarcity. Scarcity results in insufficiency of means. It is the insufficiency and it is the insufficiency of means and scarcity which introduces choice into the system. They further say that in order that choice should be, for the choice to be introduced into the system, there should be more than one use for the choice, and more than one end, that is a more than one end, should be ordered in a sequence of preference. Let me explain you using the example of water. So water is one means which can be put for multiple uses. And we all know that there was a time when there was no scarcity of water, but because of over exploitation nowadays throughout the world, we are facing insufficiency or scarcity of water. So this water, right, as a mean, it can be put into multiple use. You can use it for drinking, you can use it for cooking, you can use it for bathing, you can use it for feeding our domesticated animals, you can play with the water, you can use the water for cleaning, etc. So this is one mean or one particular material which can be put into multiple use. And suppose if there is any scarcity, if there is scarcity of water, we can arrange or we can order the multiple use into a sequence of preference. Maybe right, for us, drinking will come first, followed by cooking, then right, our pet animals and our cattle, we need them to survive, right? So we will feed them. After that, right, we may think about bathing. Then still, if some water is left, right, we may use it for gardening, cleaning vehicles and playing with water, right, we may not even think about while there is a scarcity. So remember, so water is one mean which can be put into multiple use. So according to formalist, for choice to be introduced into your system, there should be more than one use. Yes, there is more than one use for the water here. There should be more than one use. And this more than one use, or the more than one end, should be ordered in a sequence of preference. Yes, when there is scarcity, we can arrange this use of water or the multiple use of water in an order of a preference. So this is how now we have choice. The choice is yours for which purpose you are going to use the water. So the main theme of formalism is actors choose among the alternatives to maximize their preference. Yes. Now there are alternate uses for which you can put this water, and the choice is yours ultimately. But the substantivist, they refute this. They say that insufficiency in scarcity is not a factor which introduces choice into a system. They argue that as there is choice of means without insufficiency, there is also insufficiency of means without choice. Let me explain you using one example. First, the choice of means without insufficiency. See, here there is one textile showroom. If we take our woman here, our ladies here for shopping, is there any insufficiency or is there any scarcity of means here? We have abundant resource here, but don't we have choice here or not? Here, it is the abundant resources which creates choice. So here, there is choice of means without insufficiency. They say, as there is choice of means without insufficiency, there is also insufficiency of choice without means. See, insufficiency of means without choice. Insufficiency of means without choice. See here, our old telecommunication department. So prior to liberalization, before the formation of BSNL, we had our telecommunication department, and if we need a telephone connection, we need to go and apply here, and we need to wait for years together, and we are just left at their mercy. Maybe after 3 or 4 years, right, you may think about getting one telephone connection. Here, right, there is insufficiency of means. There is scarcity. there is insufficiency of means. At the same time, do we have choice? We do not have choice. So that time before liberalization, telecommunication sector, right, they were the single monopoly. If you think about telephone, we need to get it one and only through our telecommunication department. It's only after the liberalization, after the economic reforms, right, we have all these Bharti, Airtel, Vodafone, Reliance all coming to play in the telecommunication sector. So this is one good example for insufficiency of means without choice. So there is insufficiency of means, and we do not have choice also here, but formalists say that it is the scarcity and insufficiency which introduces choice. Substantivists make it clear as there is a choice of means without insufficiency, there is also insufficiency of means without choice. And further, they also say that choice may be morally induced or it may be operationally induced. Choice may be both morally induced or it may be operationally induced. So, morally induced, guys, after a very long preparation, suppose if you are in your main examination. Now, the choice is yours. Your examiner has given your answer sheet and your question paper. Either you can write from what you know. All right, you can also see what your next student is writing. You can see him and you can also write something. Or you can carry some bits, cheats here and using that also you can write. But the choice is yours. The choice is based on your morality here. Okay, so there are multiple choices here, but it is the morality which is going to decide your choice. So the choice here may be morally induced and it may also be operationally induced. So before going to your examination, right, so you may select, there is a need for you to select your best pen. So which pen you are going to use? Now there are n number of locally made and imported pens available in our market, and it depends upon the purpose. You will be selecting your pen. For examination, right, we will be selecting this particular pen. For drawing, for line drawing, you may select this thing. For calligraphy, we have different type of pen. So here the choice is operationally induced. In both the cases, insufficiency and scarcity has no role to play. Further, Dalton, George Dalton, the great substantivist, he gave the opinion that scarcity is a socially induced phenomena. Scarcity, right, occurs only in society which places greater emphasis on material acquisition than moral acquisition. In primitive societies where desirable objects themselves are limited, scarcity will not occur at all. Guys, are you okay with the first debate? Fine. The next debate is about, see, as I told you, George Dalton, the great substantivist, says that scarcity is a socially induced or socially determined condition. Scarcity occurs in society which places greater emphasis on material acquisition rather than moral acquisition. People keep thinking about buying car, buying flat, buying land, buying mobile phones, okay, buying property, but they do not think about living as a good human being, helping others. So choice occurs only, or scarcity occurs only, in society which places greater emphasis on material acquisition rather than moral acquisition. In primitive societies where the desirable objects themselves are limited, say, I've been to many small tribal hamlets, and most of the places I've seen people write them, they do not desire about many things. The bigger desire will be a happy coexistence there, a good meal and sex, nothing more than that. And suppose if any material comes into their hamlet or into their group, that material will be collectively used by everyone, and no one, right, of the jealous greed, nothing is here. So when the desirable objects themselves are limited in primitive societies, scarcity never occurs. Yes, are you okay with the first debate, the concept of insufficiency, scarcity and choice? The next debate is about the types of economy. For the formalists, right, they just have only one type of economy. Whatever economic laws which you make, according to them, it is applicable universally. We can apply it to any society on the earth. But the substantivists, they refute that, and they divide the human economy into two types: the market economy, the large and complex modern economy, and the empirical economy. So empirical economy, right, that is the economy of primitive societies. According to them, the empirical economy is an instituted process. Karl Polanyi, he further says that empirical economy is an instituted process. Guys, note it down. Sometimes right, our examiner may ask a question like this: empirical economy is an instituted process. Discuss. So empirical economy is concerned with the economy of primitive societies. Karl Polanyi further, he goes on to explain the meaning of instituted process. So according to him, empirical economy is an instituted process. He further explains what is the meaning of process and institution. By process, right, he refers to the movement of goods and commodities. Again, this movement, right, he classified this into two types: locational movement and appropriation movement. If somebody, some X or Y, if he cultivates a potato in a village, and suppose if Nagpur is the nearest marketplace, from his village he need to move that commodity to Nagpur to sell it there. So this movement is called as locational movement. After reaching Nagpur, he may meet some trader, and he will sell the goods to the trader here. So here the goods changes hand. This movement is called as appropriation movement. Appropriation movement. So process, according to Karl Polanyi, is nothing but movement, which he further classifies into locational movement and appropriation movement. And by institution, he refers to reciprocity, redistribution and exchange. So it is this reciprocity, redistribution and exchange which makes the empirical economy an institution. So once when we have an institution, then there will be a set of norms, values for the pursuit of which, right, people will enter into the organization, which may further lead to some function. Got it? So empirical economy is an instituted process according to Karl Polanyi. Then the next debate, the third debate, money, market and trade. That is a form of trade, money users and the market elements. For formalist, market is the locus of exchange. Money is the medium of exchange. And trade is the actual exchange. But for substantivist, money, market and trade have different meaning in different context. For market economy, they have a different meaning, and for the empirical economy, they altogether have a different meaning for money, market and trade. So according to substantivist, trade means it is a peaceful way of acquiring goods which are not available locally. That means the primitive people, right, if one material is not available locally, they will not go and if it is available locally, they will not go and buy it out, even if the quality is different or if there is any price differentials. So trade is a peaceful way of acquiring goods. And there are always two set of elements here involved in trade. That is the supply crowd and the demand crowd. As there are two set of people here, this two-sidedness gives rise to three types of trade: gift trade, administered trade and market trade. Gift trade is common in ceremonies, in rituals, in religious gatherings, or maybe some functions like marriage, etc. In administered trade, the centralized authority or the government will decide or fix the prices, and the market forces like demand and supply will not be allowed to influence the price. For example, in our country, urea, the price of urea is administered by the government. After subsidizing the production cost, government fixes the price of urea, and demand and supply will not be allowed to influence the cost of the commodity. The traders and merchants, they cannot alter the price depending upon the demand and supply. This is administered trade. And market trade is a trade where demand and supply will be allowed to influence the price. So the two-sidedness in the trade activity gives rise to three forms of trade: gift trade, administered trade, and market trade, according to Kalpalani. Then Dalton, he further elaborates this thing. According to Dalton, the internal and external trade mechanism, right, that is different among the primitive economy and the market economy. In primitive economy, people go for, or people import any commodity only if it is not available locally. If the commodity is available, then they will not import that commodity. But on the other hand, in market economy, even if the commodity is available locally, we may go for, the market economy will go for importing that commodity, provided there may be a difference in the quality and the price. Then the next is money users. So money, according to formalist, right, it is just a medium of exchange. And for a formalist, money is always an all-purpose money. Money serving all the purposes, like a store of value, medium of exchange. Okay, there are many more utilities. And all-purpose money serves all the purpose. But according to Karl Polanyi, empirical economy largely uses a special purpose money. Special purpose money means this money, right, will be used only for a narrow range of purposes. For example, the thief of Nigeria, they use brass rods. If you go off Philippines, they use rice as their money. We call it as the rice money. Samoyeds, the Inuits in Siberia, they use tobacco as the currency. So these are called as a special purpose money, and this money will serve only a narrow range of transactions. They can use it only to purchase a narrow range of commodities, goods and services. Karl Polanyi also adds one more thing, that is ideal units in the money users. So ideal units, right, these are mere verbalizations, or this may be an entry in a money lender's ledger or something like a check, which is not a currency, which is not a money, but which is also equal to that of a money, which carries an equal value that of a money. That he termed it as ideal units. Next is market elements. As I told you, market is just a locus of exchange for the formalist. But for substantivist, that is not the case. So here, market is a marketplace where people gather here for which one of the purpose is buying and selling goods. So here, right, Karl Polanyi speaks about market elements. According to him, there are two market elements. One is the supply and the demand crowds. Supply crowd and the demand crowd. So supply crowd is the crowd which have the commodities, who want to sell the commodity. And demand crowds are those crowd who are willing to buy these commodities. And the elements of equivalency, that is always a part of market trade. Dalton, George Dalton says that in primitive economies, that means in the empirical economies, only a few narrow range of materials will get transacted. Hardly land and labor gets transacted. According to Dalton, so in primitive economies, largely we have a marketplace, but not a market system. So there are number of formalists or number of formalists who refuted or who argued against the substantivist. For example, D.M. Goodfellow, a formalist. According to him, within one large complex society, we have peoples having local orientation, international orientation, we have primitive people and the more affluent people. And if you divide the economy, then how we can decide here that where the empirical economy starts and where it ends, and where the market economy starts and where it ends? Edward Leclerc and Scott Cook even questions why there should be a substantive meaning for economics. So according to them, right, economic anthropology should always focus on the study of the primitives, the development and the percentization of the primitives, etc. Leonard Joy, he gives an opinion that economic anthropology, right, it does not lack in adaptability, and it can suit all the conditions, and certainly it does not lack adaptability in the way in which the substantivists were arguing. Raymond Firth, right, on the other hand, he says that economic anthropology should focus on how men organize their activities in solving the problems of allocation within the set environment. But on the other hand, substantivist Paul Bohannon, he says that anthropologists are not going to ask the same set of questions like an economist. So in according to him, right, the business of anthropology is not economics, it is ethnoeconomics. Marshall Schallings was largely influenced by Karl Polanyi. He makes it clear that it is the cultural rule, it is the culture rules which decides the economic activities. And if you want to study economic anthropology, you should begin from the study of culture and cultural rules. Guys, hope you are comfortable with the topic, the formalist and substantivist debate in economic anthropology. If you have any specific doubts related to this topic, you can just text us in the comment section. Thank you.